Welcome, designing and implementing a new allocator model. I'm Jonathan Miller, I'm a German computer science student, and this is actually my first technical talk I've ever given, so I'm a little nervous. As this is the end of day one, I thought I'd give a more practical talk. I'm going to show a lot of code, and throughout this talk I will refer to you to some additional information you can find on my blog. I blog in my spare time. There is a single URL at the end. Just go there and you'll find a list of interesting things if you want to go deeper into the topic. So before we start, a quick disclaimer. I thought I made a bad joke there, but then John Kalb replied with the most horrible pun I've ever heard in a long time. Oh, that one. So I just wanted to share that with everyone. All right, so designing a new allocator model. Before we can start designing a new allocator model, I first have to tell you, why not use the existing model the STL uses? You know, you can have a vector and you can pass in an additional allocator. So I'm going to show you why the STL allocator model is bad. And I'll do that simply by presenting the STL allocator model. The rest you'll figure out yourself. So, this is an allocator, and I'm going to show you all the member functions you can write for an allocator. First of all, the allocator is templated. That is because it allocates types. It does not allocate memory, it allocates types. The allocate function there takes a size parameter, and that is the number of objects it allocates. So if you pass in 1, this will allocate size of t bytes. And similarly, the deallocate function, and yeah, there's also a max size function that returns the maximum size you can pass at the number of objects. Ignore the overload with the hint, everybody does that anyway. As it deals with objects, it also provides ways of constructing and destroying objects. With this function, they just call the constructor and destructor and maybe do some additional fancy stuff if you have a weird allocator. There are also all these type defs because the allocator does not only provide allocation function, but it also defines the entire memory model, so it defines the pointer type you can use, so you can have a different pointer type if you want that. This rebind here comes from a very old period, so where you didn't have template aliases, so you have this nested member, and it is simply, if you pass an allocator to a list, you pass in an allocator of int for a list of int, but internally the list does not allocate ints, it allocates nodes of ints. Well, the node is just the type of the two pointers, so it has to change the type the allocator will allocate, and this is what it does. We are not done. We have this slide with the wonderfully named function select on container copy construction. Apparently, you return the allocator used when you copy a container was already taken. And I'm not going to go into much detail in this slide. I've written a blog post about it and go a little bit on further on. So that was all the member functions, but we are not done yet. An allocator must also be comparable, because why not? So, that was 5 slides. Only the first one actually dealt with memory allocation. The rest was just boilerplate you can customize. You don't actually have to write all that down, though, because they have the allocator traits. The allocator traits provide defaults, so they try to call the member version. If that doesn't exist, it provides a default, and this means that the actual STL allocator you have to write is this one. That's much less than the 5 slides, but still, you only have the 2 functions you actually want to customize, the memory allocation, and you have to write a converting copy constructor, a comparison operator, the entire template, and stuff like that. So, let's improve the allocator model. We start by simply saying, this is everything we have, and ignore the entire rest. The first thing we're going to do is get rid of the template. Because if you have an allocator per type, you have one allocator that deals with float allocations, and then you have one allocator that deals with int allocations, even though mostly floats and ints are the exactly same size. So you could share the exact same object, both for floats and ints. Other example would be a pair of 2 ints, or a tuple of 2 ints. Those are basically the same types, but you have 2 different allocators. So get rid of the template. And now also the size you can pass to allocate is the number of bytes you want to allocate, and likewise for deallocate. This is how malloc does it. This also gets rid of the type dev, the weird copy constructor, and the entire complexity with rebinding and stuff. Before we go on, let's talk a little bit about allocator ownership. The standard library defined the allocator aware container concept, and this is the concept that all STL containers with an allocator use. And it specifies that an allocator aware container owns the allocator. So if you pass an allocator to an allocator aware container, the container stores a copy. If you copy and move the container around, this sometimes copy and moves the allocator around. This is controlled by the propagation I mentioned earlier. Because you can say, I want that this allocator is not changed when I assign the container, or I can say, I want it changed when I assign it. And this select on container copy construction allows customizing, so you can use a different allocator for a copy. This is all horrendously complicated stuff. And also, the get allocator function returns a copy. Again, so you pass it in, it stores a copy, and then the get allocator returns a copy. So it basically a lot of copies, and this means that the allocator must be copyable, must provide all this comparison stuff, because if two equals containers are not copy assigned, this is an optimization, and stuff like that. This is just bad. Except from the entire complication that arises in writing an allocator aware container, there is no way to directly share one allocator between two containers, because each container stores a copy, so they're using a separate container object. There's no way to actually access the underlying object a container uses, the allocator, because get allocator returns a copy. So you can't actually access the real allocator used. And the default propagation stuff, so what happens when you assign a container, does it also assign the allocator? And the answer is no, and this leads to bad move semantics and undefined behavior sometimes when you swap. So this is not really, again, my ever first blog post dealt with it. There's a link at the end. So we get rid of the propagation. Here this means that we can get rid of the operator equal equal. And practically this means that by default, a container will own the allocator, will not own the allocator, but only store a reference, because the allocator is now only required to be movable. So each container only stores a reference to the allocator, and this allows sharing. If you want a different kind of allocator storage, you can write an adapter of an allocator that stores the allocator somewhere else. An allocator is therefore allocation, so why would you want to customize all the propagation? That's not really the stuff the allocator is to deal with. Next up, we add an alignment parameter. This is a simple addition for an optimization. The default allocate function requires suitable align storage for the type, but we don't have types anymore, so we have to specify the alignment manually. And this, for example, malloc returns memory align for the maximum object, and as an optimization, you can return less aligned objects if the alignment is bigger, but also you can support over-aligned types, for example, when you have to put a type on a 1 kilobyte boundary for some reason. And then I've also splitted the allocate function into two, allocate node and allocate array. This is because some allocators are good at handling arrays, and some are really awful at handling arrays. So if you have two functions, this can be statically determined whether you're in an array allocation or a node allocation. And for example, you can have a compile error if you try to allocate an array from a container, from an allocator that doesn't support array allocations. And this allows more control over the allocations. So what we are left with is an allocator that only deals with the raw memory allocation, and that's why I called it the raw allocator. The original STL allocator contained this max size function. This might be useful for someone. I don't find it useful, so let's add it. As we have three properties, the size of the node for the node allocation, the alignment of the node, and the count in the case of array, we also make three functions, because three member functions are better than one member function. That's what standard basic string is teaching us. Also note that max array size is count times size. This is similar to a size of behaves for an array, and is just to eliminate the node size from the array size equation. Let's talk about allocator ownership again. Our raw allocator isn't owned by the container. So if you have code like this, where you have an allocator and then you pass it to container, this will store a reference to the allocator. This is all fine and good until someone does this. Now the container lives longer than the allocator, so the allocator will destroy it. This means that a smart allocator deallocates some internal memory, and you have a container with elements in already destroyed memory. This will crash, and the spaceship will explode. That's not a really nice solution to the problem. And the question is, can we do better? In the general case, though, we can. Sharing the default, you have to write an adapter to own the allocator. But when you have an allocator that actually has state, for example, we have, I'll show example of that later, you have an allocator that allocates a big block, you want that allocator to be almost global throughout the application so that every memory allocation can share this block. So you usually use it in the created and globally in main or at some high level function so it lives very long. So we don't usually create it inside some function and then return that with that. But this is only true for allocators with state. If you have a simple allocator that is a wrapper over new, this doesn't have any state. You simply forward to new. And it would be pointless to have lots of global objects for stateless allocators. But stateless allocators don't need to be owned by the container. You can write a smart allocator reference that will store a pointer if it is a stateful container, and it will store nothing if it is a stateless allocator, and when you call allocate node on the allocator reference, this will create a new stateless allocator and use that, as it's basically a static function, but required a member function because of generic reasons. So you can do this optimization, and this is what I've basically done. This means that we have to add a final property to our raw allocator, an isStateful type diff that controls whether it's stateful. And this is the raw allocator, and just by looking at the number of slides, this is obviously better than the allocator. Everything fits on one slide. And similar to the STL allocator, we can also define allocator traits for our raw allocator that provide default if you don't have the member function. And this means that the only thing you actually have to write is the deallocate and allocate node function, and the rest have default. For example, the array allocation forwards to the node allocation, the max size functions return some big value and stuff like that. So now that we've done a new allocator model, let's implement it. Let's write some allocators. This is a simple raw allocator that is a wrapper over operator new. That is all you have to write. Very simple, you just have to customize what you actually want to do, the allocation. The array allocation will also use the node allocation, as operator new doesn't care about nodes or arrays. But this allocator isn't really interesting in the same way we can use mmap or malloc or bin API's heap alloc or some C function. It's not really interesting. More useful allocators are arena allocators. And there's a lot of ambiguity around the term arena allocators. Basically, I'm sticking with the Wikipedia edition of an arena allocator is an allocator that allocates a big block and then subdivides it and returns a chunk of it. And this means that the allocation and deallocation doesn't actually have to do with OS calls or expensive stuff like that. It's just pointer manipulation after one initial actual allocation at the beginning. The most simple arena allocator is a stack allocator. I'm going to show a few paint graphics. I'm not really good at paint, so keep that in mind. It consists of a top pointer, and this top pointer is initially at the beginning of the memory block. When we want to allocate, we simply bump the top pointer by the number of bytes we want to allocate and return the allocation. So we've allocated a memory block A, and now the top pointer is there at the black line. Deallocation is limited. The only operation we have available is we can query a marker to the top. This is the red line. Now we've stored, this is basically just the location of the top pointer at some point. So we save that in a variable. Then we do a different allocation for memory block B. This again just bumps the top pointer. And to free it, we use the unwind operation that will reset the top pointer back to the marker. Now B's memory is freed because it will be overridden by the next allocation. This is a very fast, very simple allocator. It's just some pointer incrementation. It supports all size, it supports nodes, it supports arrays, it supports any alignment you pass to it. But the downside is that the deallocation is very limited. But this allocator alone is actually enough for most use cases. You can write entire games using only a stack allocator as the entire ways of memory allocation. So let's implement it. This is the interface of a simple memory stack. We have the top pointer, and we also have the end pointer because we want to detect when we are out of memory. The marker is simply the location of the top pointer. Top returns that, and unwind sets that top to a marker. The constructor allocates memory somehow and then sets the pointers, very simple. And the allocate function is a little bit more complicated than I've shown in the graphics because we also have to deal with alignment. So this align offset function calculates the offset we need to increment top so that top is a suitable aligned address. Then we check for overflow and handle that somehow through an exception, crash, whatever. And then bump the top pointer by the offset. Now top is at a suitable aligned location for the requested memory allocation. This is the value we're going to return. Then we bump it by the size, the top pointer, so that the next allocation won't override it, and then we return the previous location it was in. You might have noticed the comments there. There are a few design decisions we have to make. For example, how do we allocate memory for the big memory block? Do we use new? Do we use malloc? Do we use mmap if you're on Linux? And the second one is, what are we going to do if the stack is exhausted? Do we crash? Do we throw an exception? Do we grow, i.e. allocate a new block and set the pointer to the new block? We can't actually free the old block because we have pointers to it, so now we have two blocks and have to deal with two memory blocks. And this depends on the situation. For example, when you don't know how much memory you're actually going to use, you might want to have a stack allocator that grows instead of crashes, just went out of memory. So we want to customize memory allocation. And the way we customize memory allocation is with an allocator. So what we need is an allocator for our allocator so that we can allocate while we allocate. But this new allocator should also support growth. So we can't use a regular allocator, we have to use a special one. I've called it a block allocator because it's responsible for allocating the memory blocks in a memory arena. It does not only decide how the memory is going to be allocated, but also how much memory is going to be allocated. As it returns not only a pointer, but also has to decide about this size. We use this struct, this memory block. This is a pointer and size band. This is what it will actually return in the allocation function. So this is what a block allocator looks like. You have a constructor where you pass in the initial size. Then you have an allocate block function, a deallocate block function, and a function to query how big the next block size is going to be. If you want to prevent growth, we simply write a block allocator where after you've called allocate block once, next block size will return zero, and allocate block will handle the error, like crash, throw an exception, call a custom handler, log it, however it wants. There's a limitation, a requirement here on the user. You must call deallocate block only with the last allocated block, so the last block returned from allocate block, so in a stack-like manner, and this allows some really amazing block allocators. I have an example later of that. So the most simplest block allocator is the growing block allocator. This actually takes a raw allocator and makes it a block allocator, and it will behave basically like standard vector, where the memory block will get bigger after you've reached it. So initially you have 4 kilobytes, and you have 8 kilobytes, an additional 8 one because we can't free the original one, or something like that. So it's a very simple implementation. The allocate block uses the allocator traits to allocate an array through the given raw allocator, will set the block and grow the size, and the deallocate block will simply deallocate the array back. Now, if we want to use a block allocator, we also have to store all the memory blocks we've already in use so that they can be deallocated properly. So let's outsource that to a class, a memory arena. It looks very similar to a block allocator, but actually owns the blocks it returns and stores them in a stack. So the allocate block will allocate a block and push it onto a stack. Current block will give you the top of the stack, and deallocate block will pop the block from the stack and deallocate it so that it owns all the memory blocks and takes care of the memory block management for you. As an optimization, deallocate block can also cache the memory block in a separate list so that the next call to allocate block does not have an expensive OS allocation, but can just reuse an already allocated memory block. So our stack allocator is getting a little bit more complicated now because it needs to handle multiple stacks. memory allocation can grow the arena. So the unwind marker has to know the current block we are in addition to the position inside the block. And that also unwind also needs to release unused memory blocks back to the arena. This is how allocate blocks use the handle overflow part, that was the comment previously. We call allocate block on the arena. We set the top and end pointer, and we reset the offset, because I'm assuming here that it is suitable aligned for any given alignment. Note we can just forget about the existing top and end pointers, because they are on the arena, and the arena will deallocate them once we're done with them, so we don't have to take care of that. The marker now consists of top and end, top to identify the location in a memory block, and end uniquely identifies a memory block. And then likewise, the top function simply returns the current top and end. Unwind is a little bit more complicated. First, we have this loop that allocates blocks until we are at the block the marker specifies, and then sets the pointer. This will, of course, horribly fail if you pass in a marker to a block that's in the future. Also, was already deallocated, but that's how deallocation goes in C. The next simple arena allocator is a pool allocator. Now, a pool allocator allocates blocks of a single size. So, for example, we can have a pool of 4 bytes, and this is great for allocation 4 bytes, but it's not great for allocation of 8 bytes. So what we're doing is we have this big block, and then we subdivide it into equally sized nodes. Then we are, each node, we're storing a pointer to the next node, to the next free node. So we have a linked list, which is called a free list, because there are the free nodes. All free nodes are stored in this list. And as the memory is free, we can store the pointer intrusively into the node and don't have to do actually memory allocation for our allocator. That would be silly. If we want to allocate, we simply pop a block from the list, erase the first one. We can do that some more, and when we want to deallocate, we insert it back into the list. If we did a couple of allocation and deallocation, the list can get messy, so it's not really ordered, and this means that an arena memory pool is not really great for allocating arrays, because in an array, you have multiple nodes that are next to each other in memory, and when you have this messed up structure, you won't find them through the list without much, much overhead. And also, as I said, they only support a single size, so if you want to have multiple sizes, you have to use multiple pools. This is how you would design a pool. You have an allocate node and allocate array function here separately, because the allocate array can be more difficult to implement. The constructor also takes the initial node size. I'm not going to show you more implementation than this, because it's complicated, but if the free list is empty, we simply insert a new memory block, and else we call allocate on the free list, this will pop the node, and deallocate will put it back in. I have this pool type parameter here, that is because the memory pool, the free list it uses, can actually be customized. So we have a node pool, this is the default implementation I've shown, it's great for nodes, it's bad for arrays, and because it actually stores the pointer intrusively, each node must have at least the size of a pointer. Then I have the array pool. This keeps the free list ordered. So when you deallocate it, it will insert it into the right position in the free list in order to better support array allocations. But this has some overhead and uses a crazy intrusive XOR linked list in order to go in both directions and look for the suitable block. And then we have the small node pool. This is simply an implementation of Alexandrescu's small object allocator for modern C++ design. I don't know if you read that book. So that were two memory arena allocators, and maybe you've noticed something with their interface. They're not actually raw allocators. We spent the entire first part of the talk designing this awesome new simple model, and then I've shown you some allocator implementation that aren't actually raw allocators. And the reason is simple. A memory stack does not really support the interface required for a raw allocator. For example, the deallocate on the memory stack, we can't write that in a generic way as it is would be required by the concept, because we only have unwind to previously created marker, and that just doesn't fit with the interface. Also, note that for the memory pool, we didn't have to pass in the node size because it is implicitly known. A pool can only allocate memory for a given node size. But they're actually raw allocators anyway, and that is because they have specialization of the raw allocator traits. So if you have a memory pool and you know that it is a memory pool, you can call the member function, the specific member function that is specifically designed for a pool and the most efficient way to do it on a pool. But if you have some generic context, you can access the traits, but you've obviously lost the specific interface because you're now dealing with generic types. And I think this is a great way of doing it. You have the specific interface if you know what you're doing, what allocator you're dealing with, and this general interface if you have some generic code that needs to do memory allocation. Thanks to Alexandrescu's talk at last year's CPPCon, I must not talk about allocators without also mentioning composition. How many of you have watched the talk about allocator design? Okay, a few. So he designed this memory allocator library where you can easily combine multiple allocators into a new one, so you can take that and plug that in there, and then you have a combination of two allocators. And FKina have the same thing already with the block allocators. So let's write some more advanced block allocators. The growing block allocator is just a dump wrapper of a raw allocator and doesn't really use the flexibility a block allocator can have. For example, we can write a static block allocator. This will use this storage variable. A static allocator storage is, this is just a type def for an aligned char array of the given size, and it will use this storage you pass in for the entire allocation. It supports one call to allocate block, and this will return the entire storage of the memory. If we call it a second time, this will error in the default implementation, it will throw an exception there. And this allows, you can use this one in a memory pool, for example, and then you have a memory pool that completely uses stack memory, or wherever you put that storage variable. You can also write a virtual block allocator. So if you use it like so, this will reserve 16 kilobytes of virtual memory, and can allocate 16 additional blocks. Each call to allocate block will commit 1 kilobyte in this case, because 16 divided by 16 is 1, and then the second call will commit the next one. Now, if you deallocate it, this will decommit the previously allocated virtual memory. And that is why I've required that you use it in a stack-like manner, to actually use memory stack inside a block allocator. This is not really a memory stack like the one I've shown you, this is just a more simple implementation. So with those block allocators, you can, for example, have a memory pool, like I mentioned, a static block allocator, then you have a memory pool that uses stack memory, and then you can take that memory pool and plug that into an STL container, like a set, and then you have a binary tree without dynamic memory allocation that lives entirely on stack memory. You can also, another interesting combination is a memory stack with a virtual block allocator, and then you have a stack that is virtual memory aware. So it will have a fixed size. This is determined to the block allocator, the 16 kilobytes in the example previously, and then it will commit a bigger chunk of the big chunk, so 1 kilobyte, and then it will work on the stack like that. And if the stack is exhausted, it will commit the next one and work there. This is a really powerful stack implementation, and I've read many blog posts where this is a separate class. So you have a class that is specifically designed, a memory stack for virtual memory. And here, this is just a combination of a block allocator with a memory stack. This is a very flexible design. We can also write a composition in a different way. So a memory pool collection takes multiple free lists, and they share one arena. And each free list has a different size, and so the allocation selects the appropriate free list for the allocation, and the deallocation also. And because they share one arena, there's just one memory allocation at the beginning, and it will give equally sized memory to each pool, and then it has some heuristics to determine how much it should grow each pool and stuff like that, but it just shares one big arena for multiple sizes. And you can customize with a policy which size it should map to each free list. For example, you can have a memory pool collection with a free list where for each size you have a free list, so for 1 byte, 2 bytes, 3 bytes, 4 bytes, and so on. Or for example, for each power of 2, you have a free list, so you're not wasting more than half of the memory for a smaller allocation. But this isn't really what Andre demonstrated with his compositioning. He had allocators where He, for example, he had a fallback allocator where he could, where we, first tries one allocator that didn't succeed, it uses a different one. And then the problem is the deallocation has to know from which allocator the memory came, so it couldn't call the appropriate deallocation. But this means that an allocator has to know, you can, it has, he has this owns member function where you can pass in a pointer, and it will tell you whether that pointer was allocated by this container. And this is obviously can't be implemented for all kinds of containers, allocators. For example, a new allocator, you don't know, given a pointer, whether it was allocated with new and this allocator without some big overhead or platform-specific hacks. So instead, I've made a composable raw allocator concept, and this is just a raw allocator with these additional member functions, and these are try, or member functions, or traits specializations, and these are try allocation and try deallocation function. The raw allocator allocate function must not return null pointer. It must run exception or terminate or do whatever, but it must not return a null pointer. This just gets rid of a branch whenever you do an allocation. So, but this function does and is required to return null pointer if it has encountered an allocation failure, so it can't allocate this much memory. The try deallocate node function must handle any pointer, so you can pass any pointer to it, and it will return true if it can if it was able to deallocate it, i.e. if that pointer previously came from the allocator. And this allows the implementation of Andrew's fallback allocator in a very simple way. So this would be the allocate node. We first go the default allocator and call try allocate node there. So the default one is required to be a composable allocator. But if that didn't work, we can use a regular raw allocator at the fallback allocation. This will throw an exception or crash or do whatever when we, it can't do that, but the function will never return null pointer. And then the deallocation also first tries to deallocate it using the composable allocator. If that doesn't work, it forwards to the fallback allocator because it must came from the fallback allocator, otherwise the client has passed an invalid pointer to it and then it's not the allocator's fault. This is all great, all I've shown you, but it's not really that useful on its own. We have to have some boilerplate. This is stuff that makes allocators easier to use. For example, a wrapper standard allocator is an STL allocator that where you pass in a raw allocator, and it will use the raw allocator for allocation. And it will obviously share the raw allocator because a raw allocator only must only be movable, whereas you can copy an STL allocator around as much as you want. So this allows using a raw allocator inside an STL container. Then you also have storage, like I mentioned the allocator reference, that does the smart reference behavior, where you don't actually have to store any reference to it, so you can pass in a temporary stateless allocator because it doesn't actually care what you pass to it, at it and it will create it on the fly. But you can also have a type-erased allocator reference or one that owns the allocator, and then it has to figure out what to do on copying and advanced stuff like that. There are also adapters, for example, tracking allocator takes a raw allocator and a tracker, and it will call a member function on the tracker object each time it does an allocation and a member function on the tracker object each time it does a deallocation, so you can track how much memory you're using, if, whether you're having any leaks and stuff like that. And you can, the implementation of the raw allocators, you can use debugging helpers like leak checking directly or fill the memory with debug values or allocate an additional fence memory around each memory allocation so you can detect when you're overflowing, when you have a buffer overflow in your code and stuff like that. And with this boilerplate, it is very easy to use a raw allocator. For example, we want to use a standard list with a memory pool. The first question is, how do we know what the node size is supposed to be of that list? Because it doesn't store an int, a list of int doesn't allocate ints, it allocates a node of ints, so it has some platform-dependent size. And I've written a code generator, this is an extra build system check that determines the node size on your computer, and it provides them as compile-time constants. So you can, this node size will be the node size required on the, your implementation for, your, for a list node of ints. And then you can create a memory pool. It has 4 kilobytes, an initial memory block of 4 kilobytes with that node size, and it uses the default block allocator, which will grow. And then we can use that pool in our list. This I've provided convenience type dev, so you don't have to type this one out. So memory list of int memory pool is the same as the one above. This gets even bigger if you have a set where you have the key and then comparison and then finally the allocator. So you have 4 lines of type just for a custom allocator. So I've provided this convenience type dev. But this is just a regular standard list, so you can use it like normally. And every allocation will be done through the memory pool. Now, that's the talk I've planned. Then I gave it, and as you've probably guessed, I still have lots of time left. So this was last week, so I kind of had to do something else because I didn't want to do it early. So I'm now going to talk, I have a few bonus slides, and I'm going to talk about a feature I've implemented last week, and this is a really cool one. So consider this type. If you do, so it's just a temporary struct, we have a standard string, we have a standard vector of ints, then a constructor. Now, what is the memory layout when we want to dynamically allocate an object of my type? It will look something like this. So on the left, we have the memory for the type with the string and the vector, and then the string points to characters. I'm ignoring here small string optimization, and then the vector points to additional memory. So each the string and the vector allocates additional memory. And even if you have a memory pool used for the MyType allocation, they still do expensive heap allocation. So this is bad. There's a 3 allocation, whereas you could actually do it in 1. Then you have, on the left, you have the object, so the string and the vector, and then the memory for the characters of the string, and the memory for the elements of the vector. If you know how many characters you need and how many vector elements you need, and you can know that beforehand. And this is where joint allocations kick in. I've created a facility that allows exactly that. And in order to use it, we first of all have to derive from this type, the joint type. This is some base class that will insert some boilerplate into the MyType, 2 pointers in fact, so that it can manage the additional memory that comes after the object. In order to use it, we have to pass in, for example, to our standard string, we have to pass in a joint allocator, and again, memory string, this is just an alias for basic string, char, char traits, char, standard allocator, char, joint allocator. And the joint allocator, this will take an object with joint memory in the constructor and will use the joint memory of the object for all allocations. Now, this has a little bit of overhead because it has, and the allocator has an additional pointer. So the size of the string object increases by the additional pointer. So where you just want a dynamic collection of stuff, you can use joint array. And this is a dynamic fixed size array. So this has a fixed size. It does not support growth. But you can, but the fixed size does not need to be known on compile time. So this is basically a standard vector, but it cannot grow. We have to augment the constructor so that we can pass in the joint tag. This is a tag object, and it does 2 things. First of all, it prevents accidentally creation of my type without the shared memory, joint memory, because you can't create the tag type. Only a friend of the class can do that. And second, it contains meta information about the joint memory, so the size. So you have to pass the tag to the base class. And then this will set up the pointers for managing the shared memory. We have to use the allocator constructor of standard string. So we pass in the string and then this object, because this is the object where we want the shared memory from. And likewise, we can go the same with our joint array. And then we will have, they will allocate memory, but they will allocate it from the joint memory of the object. So no additional allocation, and we get this memory layout. Now to create this, we use this function. This takes the type, that this must be a joint type. We pass in the allocator we want to use for the allocation of the joint memory. and you can and the size of the additional joint memory. So where the three dots are, you have to compute how much space you want. So you want 10 characters and then 10 in, so you have to do stuff and keep in mind of alignment. It's kind of ugly. I'm working on improving that a little bit, but it does the job. And then you also pass in the additional characters. Now this will allocate one memory block big enough for the storage of my type and the additional memory for the joint memory. And it will create my type into it, and this will give you the layout you want. The return type is a joint pointer. This is similar to unique pointer. It owns a pointer of the given type, so you can just access the elements normally. But when the pointer gets destroyed, it will also deallocate the joint memory. So this facility allows you to, you can obviously wouldn't use the default allocator there, but some pool, for example, or some stack, and then you can have an object where the members are completely in line there. So that was my talk. I'm still finishing early, so we can discuss a lot about allocators if you want. Thank you for listening. I think there's a microphone.
I'm very glad you showed your bonus slides, because there you illustrated something that really irks me about the current allocators, and that the method for allocating a type is now encoded in the type.
Yeah.
So why should I care? I want to use a type, right? I'm writing a function that's being passed the reference to that structure that you showed. Mm-hmm. Why do I care it was allocated with a joint allocator? Why does the method of allocation have to be encoded in the type system?
Because there are the, in C++17, there will come the polymorphic memory resources, and this will have define a class hierarchies of allocators, which are similar to mine, but a class hierarchy, and they have virtual functions for the allocation. And what I've did is I've templated, so the information is encoded in the type, but this is simply an optimization, because it is faster to, if you have a template instead of doing the virtual function. So if you want to have a type erased allocator, I've provided one in the library, and any allocator reference, this is just an allocator to this is a type erased version, so you can have use that in every type, and then all types are the same regardless whether they use the allocator, but with a slight one-time overhead. And this also works in combination with standard allocator. So, where was that slide? Here. Instead of writing memory pool here, you can write memory any allocator, and this will do the type erased version that is slightly slower, but then you don't have to take care of the type.
All right, but I think then you get into troubles, like what if you copy between, or you move or swap types that are really allocated with different allocators?
That's what the propagation, this is customizable, and the standard allocator will have propagation, so if you swap, this will also swap the allocators. So it won't run into...
What if you can't do that? What if you need to actually copy the memory because you're swapping the value, right? But you can't just swap the pointers or the allocators because it's not owned by the component that receives the copy.
If you're using, for example, lists copy constructor, this will still use new, this will by default copy the allocator and use the same allocator for the allocation. But if you don't want that, you can use the copy constructor where you can pass in an additional allocator. So you can pass an extra allocator used for that allocation. But this is in the scope of the STL or containers. I just defined the framework for the allocators. So.
All right. Thank you.
I have a question about this last joint allocator, actually. What happens if you push back to the string or the vector or whatever?
So you mean when you do a pushback here?
Yeah.
This will try and allocate from the joint memory. And if the joint memory is exhausted, it will throw an exception. The generic one will call a handler, and the default handler will throw an exception, because it simply can't
So then basically the joint memory, you may say it's a bigger area that you actually need initially, just in case you need to push back elements afterwards, for example.
Yeah, it's a bigger area, but for that I've provided, I haven't shown it, a clone joint function. This will take an existing joint object, allocate as much memory as precisely used by this object, and copy everything over. So then you have an object, the joint pointed to joint memory, where it's exactly as big as needed, as soon as you know how much memory you need.
I don't totally follow. So so let's say I push back to one of the elements, right?
Yeah.
The container where I'm pushing doesn't know about the joint allocator. So it's going to deallocate the old memory and allocate some new one. So you need to basically leave a gap there, because you cannot move the elements from the other containers, right?
You mean when you have a pointer of joint memory, when you have a container of joint memory objects? Or to which container?
Yeah, let's say I have a reference to one joint allocated object, right?
Yeah.
And this has two things, a string and an array.
Yeah.
Or a vector.
Yeah.
I push back something to the vector, so the
vector
is going
to... But it would use the string.
Huh?
But you push back something to the vector, and then the vector would grow. And this, then the growing will try to allocate what vector does, a new buffer, copy over, release the old one. Yeah, that doesn't really work with the joint memory as it... Yeah, as you said, this is more for a situation where you have dynamic fixed-size memory, so you know how much memory you're going to...
Yeah, so in your construction, you said...
Yeah, and that's exactly why the joint array does not support pushback, it just...
You showed a list, STD list example, and previously you said that the standard allocators have comparison for equality.
Yeah.
Can you compare your allocators for equality?
No, what the standard allocator actually uses internally, it uses allocator reference. And for stateless allocators, the comparison is always true, because they have no state. For stateful allocators, they will compare the pointer inside the allocator reference, so if they compare to the exact same object, because that's the definition for the equivalent. And if you have, for example, the polymorphic memory resources, they are referenced as well, and I provide a wrapper over a polymorphic memory resource so that it is a raw allocator, so you can use those. And they have already referenced semantics. And for those, you can specialize a trait so that allocator reference will store the allocator directly because it has reference semantics and will forward to the comparison of the allocator. So it will work as you'd expect.
Okay, thanks. The reason I was asking was because for STD list, there's the splice operation, which requires the allocators to be equal.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm asking if you can check for this at runtime.
Yeah. You can, the standard allocator does, but the raw allocator itself does not, because...
thank you for the talk, and I have a question about performance. So you say that like comparing to new polymorphic resources, like that will be probably like new standard or something.
Yeah.
That you don't use like virtual methods to allocate, but do you do any like measurements, like for the performance? I mean, like gain something.
I did. This would also be on the URL link there. You will find I have a series where I optimized my library and described what I did on my blog post, and I can try and find the profiling results right now. I compared it to Boost Pool, because someone asked about that. Not this one, this one. So I compared my pool implementation and stack. And this one here, we are first allocating a single node. This is would be using malloc. This would be using new. These are my pools, my small pool, my node pool, my array pool, and here are the boost version, and this would be a stack allocator. I will update these benchmarks if they are not. Yeah.
Thank you.
So I think that's it.